canceled out Steph.
Yes.
53 points, 7 for 15 from long range, 6 for 14 for Steph, 47 points. It was who else was going to step up. And that whole idea that role players play better at home, you can put that to bed. And I would expect you could put that to bed for game 4 as well. The Raptors demonstrated that they are not just Kawhi Leonard by a long stretch, that there are other guys that are capable of stepping up, and that was the difference.
I agree. I thought it was balanced. The team overcame a great individual performance, and that's what you have to have. Either in a situation like this, when someone goes for a monster game, Skip, either you have to have an individual on the other team to cancel him out, and this is what makes them so hard to beat. So no matter what your team can do, they got a KD that can match. They got a Klay that can match. And then you got Klay and Steph, or you got KD and Klay, Steph. So you got three guys that's going to snuff out anything individual performance. We saw that last year, 51 against LeBron.
This ultimately, though, is the big difference and why I was always questioning, could the Warriors do it again? Because they've talked about the strength in numbers, and we've seen it in glimpses.
Right.
But at the very top, in the ultimate games, their bench is not the same.
No.
Andre Iguodala, for all that he is not the same.
No.
Sean Livingston, not. That's why he's planning to retire. He's not close. And they haven't added anything. And quietly, the guy that we're not talking about, Kevon Looney, was a huge absence. Because defensively, if you want to know why they had all those uncontested layups at the rim, is because they didn't have a big man who was agile enough to play the pick and roll and get back and defend the rim.
And so, that's the biggest thing. And you look at, you keep talking, you said the Warriors bench. Okay, role players play well at home if you got good role players. When you start looking at, really all they got is Quinn Cook. That's it, Skip. Bogut has seen his best days. Jarepko's seen his best days. Alfonso McKinney, you counting on Jordan Bell? Van Fleet is going to give you 10 to 15 a night. Anything that you get out of Serge, Serge was huge. Now, I believe
defensively.
I believe three of those were goaltending, Skip, but that's not, they missed enough calls.
Two of them.
So they made up for that carry that Steph Curry did, and that and one they should have gave Kawhi, and the foul. Because you know Serge blocked McKinney's dunk, too. That was a clean block. But anyway, it was the balance. And if they can keep getting balanced performances like this, five guys score 17 or more, they can offset anything that Steph throws at them unless someone else comes along for the ride.
You guys are being prisoners of moment on how bad the Golden State role players are. They are all capable of having big nights, and I believe three or four will have big nights on Friday night, tomorrow night.
You better.
Now back to Jen's question. To me, the final score of this game and the biggest reason that the visiting team won was 17-12, because in the end, you can wipe everything away. Golden State still lives and dies, especially at home, by the three-point shot. Toronto goes into their house and makes 17 threes to 12 for Steph's team. That is extraordinary, and it tilted the playing field in Toronto's favor because they made 45% of the threes that they took. That's Steph-esque. That's his realm, not in the 45% range. Golden State made 33% of his three-point shots. When that happens, the visiting team has a real good chance of winning that game, and it won it handily because there were also timely threes because they kept canceling any run that Golden State even thought about making. And again, the biggest run they had the whole game was 7-0, and then number two hit his biggest shot of the night. He hit a three that pushed it back to 10.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, Van Vliet is making a three. And then Danny Green has a salvo of threes at the end of the third quarter where he makes three inside of 2 minutes. Well that's hard to that's Splash Brothers-esque.
But you are asked, right? Danny Green, we've seen play on this platform before.
I told him yesterday, I said, you better be careful. I know him.
He was doing what Steph Curry was doing before Steph Curry was doing it. In the Spurs against the Miami Heat.
He can go crazy. Well, he set the record in 2013, and he did it in 5 games.
Right.
So the fact is, we shouldn't be surprised that he would step up and do this.
All right.
Are you expecting
he will come and he will go. He will also go cold.
Are you expecting Quinn Cook
maybe
to have a legendary game in the finals. Alfonso McKinney.
Well, he already had
Jonas
one.
Jonas Jerebko.
Like Quinn already had pretty. That was pretty legendary, wasn't it?
Yes.
He made three.
It's. But again, it was as a complimentary piece. You want him to take that next step. Is it realistic to think that they are going to nail those threes, particularly when what opens it up for them is when they have the threat of the back cut?
Mm-hmm.
And they don't have that with these guys. They weren't worried about them finishing at the rim. Mm-mm. Draymond Green was coming down and trying to press the pace. He would get to the paint and see all these, what are all these guys doing in here? And then he would throw the lob. Well, they could stay at home on the lob because Draymond Green's not going to be shooting 10-foot floaters.
Right.
And there's nobody on the perimeter that he can kick it out to.
Mm-hmm.
Andre Iguodala hit a couple, 2 for 6. That's not enough to threaten you. So ultimately, if you don't have those floor spacers, then you're not going to get this. And again, I will start with Marcus Gasol punishing DeMarcus Cousins right from the start.
Yeah.
Just set a tone for this game. Yep. For everything else, it wasn't a convincing win for me for the Raptors. I kept thinking, you guys are playing with fire. You're keeping it at 10, 12. That's not enough. Something could happen. But ultimately, they did enough to put their imprint on it, and it was the role players that did it.
This is when you know the Warriors were in trouble, Skip. The Raptors go 5 minutes and I think 47 seconds without scoring a basket, and they couldn't get it under 10. If you go hold a team that long, almost 6 minutes, and the closest you can get it is 10, you got no chance.
Mm.
But that's the difference. You get Klay there. Now, I mean, even though only one guy can hurt you, and that's Steph, and he goes for 47. Can you imagine if he had Klay, someone they got to play close attention to also? They had three guys that have more three-pointers than anybody else other than Steph.
Okay. Again, I'm going to say this one more time. Steph had 47 points, but they were quiet variety points by his standards. Because where he kills you, where he shoots you out of the gym and off the floor, is with salvos, where all of a sudden he goes crazy, inexplicably hot for a five-minute stretch where he makes four straight threes. He didn't do that last night. We didn't get the explosion because the explosion's hard to overcome at Oracle. The crowd never quite could get into the game where they explode along with the team.
Well, give them credit, Skip, for chasing him because they was hell-bent on chasing him off that line. You can hit, like you said, take all the twos you want. Get all the floaters you want.
And he got to the free throw line, but the twos and the free throws don't do it. They don't incite the crowd.
The magic of Steph Curry is that he's able to get big numbers and get it in an efficient way that still allows Klay to go off.
Right.
AD to go off. There was nobody else to do that. And you said earlier about him being overrated or undersized. He's undersized.
Yeah.
And then you got Quinn Cook and Steph Curry in the backcourt against that long athletic Toronto team. You're going to have issues. He is an overachiever. Last night, he could not have done more.
No.
He defended, he rebounded, he scored efficiently.
He assisted.
He did everything you could ask him to do.
What he could do more is have one of those magical runs. He's got like 23 in the fourth quarter at Houston.
So, in other words, you want him to have 70. You want him to have 70.
No, I'm just saying 23 in the fourth quarter. That when I sat back and said, that's top 10 all time. There are few humans who have ever played this game who could do that in that building.
But what he knows and what the Warriors know, and this is really their secret sauce, Steph Curry's superpower is that he knows who he is. He knows he's not Kobe. He knows he's not Michael.
Right.
And the Warriors know collectively. Now, everybody wants to break it down. Well, how would Draymond do someplace else? Or he can't play without Klay and Steph, and Steph can't play without Klay. You don't have to convince them of that. They know that, and they're good with it.
Right.
They're like, hey, you know what? You guys can break us apart and say what we are and aren't individually. All we know is
together.
When we play together, we win championships. Mm.
Yeah, that's what they try to do, Skip. They try to do that to us.
Mm.
Well, what would Skip do without old Shea? What would Shea do without Skip? I don't know. But together, we will.
That's a good
hard
question.
Hard to imagine. All right, we got to talk about KD and Klay and the future of Game 4 with you, Rick. So we're going to ask you to stick around.
Let's do it.
This will be
good. Will they be back tomorrow night? We'll discuss that coming up next.